Hola, amigas. I'm Norma, your host here at Latinas and Libros Book Club. I'm so, so excited to welcome you to this month's Latinas and Libros Book Chat Series. This month, we have the pleasure of speaking to Alejandra Campoverdi about her new book, First Gen. This is a beautiful memoir, and it's so near and dear to my heart because as a first gen kiddo, I felt so incredibly seen. If you haven't already picked up this fabulous book, do yourself a favor. Ahorita, vayan a agarrarlo. Go get it. It's amazing. So this is part memoir, part manifesto. First Gen is the story of generational inheritance, of aspiration, of empowerment, the true meaning of belonging, a gripping journey to reclaim the parts of ourselves we sacrifice in order to survive. Amigas, please join me in welcoming Alejandra Campoverdi.
Hello, I have been looking forward to this conversation with you, Norma, and hi, Anna, and hello to the community. This community is a special place in my heart, so I'm so excited to talk today.
We're so incredibly happy you're here, Alejandra. So thank you again. Your book has become a bestseller. I have seen you out in the circuit. You are working so incredibly hard. We appreciate your time and we really appreciate you being here with us today. I'm so excited to be chatting with you. Let's jump right in.
Do it.
All right. Why don't we start with a little bit of your background? Will you tell us when you started thinking about writing this book and how you knew it was time to release it into the world?
So I started kind of thinking through this theme, or I should say more than the theme, just the idea of, you know, the parts of our story that tend to be glossed over and tend to not make it onto the pages of our lives. When I would give a lot of talks to young people, it's always been something that I've been drawn to doing. And I talk about this in the book. I was giving a talk at a school. They have a Latinx graduation at Harvard, and I had been asked to speak there. And I noticed on the young people's faces, kind of like I felt some energy that was similar to what I had felt when I was there. And it was, of course, you know, pride to be graduating, and, you know, their families were there. It's a beautiful bilingual graduation. But there was also kind of almost like a little sadness behind some of the young people's eyes. And I recognized that same feeling when I would get to these different achievement pinnacles. And when I was introduced and they kind of gave those bullet points that were all usually distilled down to, you went to this school, you got this job, you sit on this board, whatever it is, it just felt so incomplete and almost misleading about the reality of what actually had happened in my life. And it didn't feel like I was doing anyone any sort of service by continuing to perpetuate some glossy linear narrative that seemed like I had it all figured out and I was somehow exceptional, because all of us are on this same journey and all of us are facing similar things. And I didn't want to be quiet about that anymore. So I started changing how I would speak to young people. And I started saying many of the things that are in this book. And what I saw were a lot of tears and a lot of nodding heads. And I thought, okay, this is a string I want to pull and I want to explore in myself. And, you know, and if hopefully other people identify with it, that's beautiful. But it felt like it was widespread. It felt like it was all of us. So I sat down during COVID is when I got the book deal and I started writing the book. And we all know it was a really isolating, lonely time in a lot of ways. And in the beginning of COVID, I was living alone. So all this stuff was coming up and I thought, well, if it's going to come up, I can either push it back down all over again, like I'm kind of accustomed to doing, or I can root it up on purpose and really try to explore this experience and deconstruct it. So that was the origins of the book.
Alejandra, thank you for being so brave and for exploring those parts of your story and of yourself that so many of us often don't, and for giving all of us a voice. And for, I think if you have read this, if you're about to read this and you're first gen, I think you're really going to see yourself in this story. You're going to say there are going to be moments as this story unfolds that you are really going to feel seen and held and understood. And Alejandra, I think it takes a very special person to be able to so clearly and concisely talk about an experience that so many of us feel, and yet we have a hard time putting words to that experience because we're so busy living it.
Well,
we're so busy.
It's true what you're saying. You know, you're really hitting it on the nose. That I say this in the book, that there's a saying about when you're skating over thin ice, your speed is your safety. And I feel like in many ways that is a part of the first gen experience. You know, we're all kind of surviving and morphing and adapting and being resourceful and trying to kind of outpace a lot of what we almost feel is a predestined path that we don't always want to walk on. And I don't want to make it seem like it's all negative. You know, I don't know how many people here have read the books. I know we're in the beginning of November, so I don't want to assume that everyone has read the book. But, you know, the book is not depressing. Like, it's not like a negative, like, oh, God, I'm really excited to read this book about all the hard things about being first gen. I know about the hard things. Like, everyone here on this chat could have written this book, because we all have these same experiences. So I don't posit myself as some sort of expert first gen person or trauma expert or psychologist or anything. So much as, you know, this was a journey to really speak the truth and acknowledge the truth of a lot of experiences that I didn't feel like a lot, I had space to even feel many times. As a child, you know, a part of the trailblazer toll, which I'm sure we'll get into, as a child, I was really good and felt like I had to shove down a lot of my experience in order to kind of preserve the oxygen around me. And like, there was so much kind of chaos that I almost felt like, well, my job is to be the good kid, right? And the like adult kid.
And yeah, I feel like so many of us can relate to that experience. So let's talk for a minute, Alejandra. Can you, for those amigas who haven't yet read the book, I want readers to know that Alejandra's memoir is packed with super relatable first gen experiences, and she shares specific tools to help us unpack some of our experiences. So Alejandra, can you tell us a little bit about why you decided to weave in certain resources? So I'm thinking about the ACE tests, genograms. Tell us a little bit more about how you decided on the flow of the book.
Well, as you will see when you read the book, there's two answers to that, which is there's the overarching one, which is the trailblazer toll is something that I call out in the very beginning of the book. And what that is basically naming the emotional toll of social mobility for those of us who are first gen. Not because it's, you know, there's eight components that I lay out, not because those eight components are the only ones, so on, but because it to create an understanding that a jumping off point where this is actually a comprehensive experience, not just imposter syndrome, which is what we hear a lot about. And I have my own bone to pick with, but I'm sure we'll get there. But there's so many different dynamics and they move throughout our lives. And they aren't only when we're students, you know, they're when we're professionals, when we're children, when we're accomplished, right? And so this eight components of the trailblazer toll, I weave them into every chapter. So each chapter is a different toll. And I use stories from my life to illustrate that toll. So that's how it lays out. Mm-hmm. That was a little complicated getting into the sausage making about, you know, in the beginning, it was like, well, if you're writing a memoir and then you pull folks out and kind of make it general, like how does that really go together? And it took kind of some kind of massaging on my side so that it hopefully doesn't pull people out of narrative and allows us to kind of calibrate what these stories are in a larger constellation. Because
go ahead. I'm sorry.
I was going to say, because it's not unique to me. That's the point. And so going through these stories as if they're just mine, to me, felt false. And again, as to my earlier point, felt like not the point of the book, because I don't know about you guys, but I feel like we have a lot of memoirs that are super inspirational. This person did a great job and we can be inspired by them. And I certainly have liked reading books like that. And, you know, there's also room for a little more nuance about sometimes folks that do things fall flat on their faces on the way and take risks that maybe could have gone completely the wrong direction, which a lot of the choices I made could have. I could have fallen flat on my face and sometimes did repeatedly. I think those are important stories to tell too, because then, you know, we realize, okay, when that happens to me, that doesn't mean that it's over. That doesn't mean that somehow I misstepped and I'm off my path and I'm not going to be able to make it to XYZ, whatever that thing is. It just means, okay, you get back up, and a lot of us are really good at that. We get back up and we keep going. They always say it's like the champions aren't the ones, you know, that are don't fall down. They're the ones that are really good at getting back up. So the reason why I wrote those resources to your question, Norma, is because honestly, I also didn't want to point at all these things and then be like, good luck to you. You know, I wanted to point at these things that help me. I don't know if they'll help other folks, but marking the trees as best I can about those things and how I move through that, you know, I leave them there as a kind of my own kind of heart offering of these are the ways that I help myself. One of them, to your point, is a genogram. And it's one of the trailblazer tolls, which is invisible inheritances, these cycles that predate us and our families. And again, the idea of generational trauma isn't a new one, but this is a little bit more complicated than just generational trauma, because there's beautiful cycles that are generational cycles. And guess what? They're usually intertwined with the suffering. You know, I had two generations of women in my family that left emotionally abusive relationships when they were pregnant. I don't want to continue that cycle, but guess what? They also left abusive relationships while they were pregnant. Like, wow, like the fortitude to want to protect your baby and yourself and to make such a difficult decision. That's a beautiful cycle, right? And the idea of what cycles do we want to continue? Because I say in the book, each day we have the choice to be a better ancestor, become a better ancestor. We're setting cycles as we speak. So in the book, so you understand what we're talking about, there's this genogram. Show it. So you see this right here. It's like, a genogram is an emotional, it's a family tree of emotional inheritances. And I didn't come up with this, but I put a blank one there in case anyone wants to create one, because it really helped me. And the idea is, you know, there's all these symbols that connect these relationships through generations, whether it's love or neglect or manipulation or separation, all these different things. And this is one of the ways that it really helped me to kind of take a step back and look at these cycles, because, you know, you can't heal from that which you don't name. And there's also, I mean, I can go on forever, so I'll stop there, but the ACE test was really important for me to also list, because to folks that aren't familiar, again, this is the adverse childhood experiences test, and it's a number of questions about things that happened in your childhood. That I know a few years back when I finally took that test and I looked at it and I looked at its implication on our health and I looked at what my score was, which I'll spare you guys, but it was pretty high. And that was, even though these things were hard to look at and a lot of these things are hard to swallow, the acknowledgement that there was a reason why, you know, I had people-pleasing tendencies because of being parentified, or I had anxiety disorder I developed as a child that I talk a lot about in the book, the mental health aspect, because of these ACE adverse childhood experiences. It helped me to validate my own experiences, which was the beginning of my healing journey.
Oh, I love that. I love that you included these resources. And as a reader, and I think a lot of the readers will probably agree with me, I felt like the resources and the way that you weave them together with your own story and how you manage these resources really actually invites the reader in. Because not only are you saying, look, there's this test, there's this, there's this methodology which you can employ for your own history, we also get to see it in real time. We get to see you going through the process. We get to see you learning from it. And I think it's tremendously, tremendously helpful as a reader. And it's also very connecting. When you talk about invisible inheritances, for example, you say, as you're trying to unpack what your first and only experience is, you ask a question that just blew my mind. You asked, you're writing and you say, what were the generational cycles I was born to break? So this is on page 30, amigas. And you say, when I came across this question, Alejandra, it really shifted the way I was thinking about my own story and about the way I conceptualize what my role is here. Because I think that as first gens, as trailblazers, we often find ourselves alone. Mm-hmm. We often find ourselves in situations where our family and our immediate circle, our immediate community of support system can't really help us. And so to conceptualize our journey as, wait, what are the generational cycles I was born to break? I think that's so incredibly powerful and big picture. Can you tell us a little bit about how you came up with this answer, how you came up with the question, and how you answered it for yourself?
Well, that's one of the reasons why I felt motivated to write this book, because of how alone it feels. And look at already the community that it's building, even all of us here talking about it. So I'm just so grateful for this space. I came up with the question because, there is that isolated feeling of responsibility. Sometimes it feels a little heavy, like, okay, am I the one responsible for breaking every cycle? Yeah. We're the kind of chosen ones somehow. And while that's really beautiful, it's a lot of pressure. And I do believe, I believe we have a soul. I don't know what folks believe, soul, energy, whatever folks believe, and I do believe that first and only, as I call them in the book, we have a very particular soul's journey. It's a very unique person who believes completely, almost irrationally, in their capacity to do things against all odds. And for a lot of us, I don't know about you guys, but it kind of comes inherently. Did anyone ever say, okay, you're going to be the one, it's your responsibility? I mean, maybe later people validate it to us and say, we follow you, you're the smart one, or you're the capable one. But that's kind of after the fact.
That's right.
There is kind of this inherent light in those that I feel is their soul's journey to kind of challenge the predestiny that almost seems to live in the cycles of our family. Like by being first gen, you're inherently breaking cycles of struggle. Otherwise you wouldn't be breaking them. So what were the cycles that we're born to break? How do we be intentional about it? That's what's behind that question, because we can break all sorts of cycles and we can spend the rest of our lives stressing ourselves out into the ground trying to break cycles. But what are the ones that we were born to break, right? And looking at that for myself really helped me unravel that, I didn't have to kind of save everyone as a part of this journey, because our families are on their own soul's journey as well. And that wasn't about abandoning anyone or letting go of any responsibility to help my family. I'll speak for myself so much as accepting that journey, it didn't mean that I had to constantly be in pain because other folks didn't see this shift needing to happen in our entire family. It made that aloneness be okay in a lot of ways. I know I'm kind of veering off of your question, but it's all wrapped together because the last trailblazer toll is breakaway guilt. And that idea that a lot of times what's the other side of the coin? I'm always talking about two sides of a coin. the other side of the coin of invisible inheritances and cycle breaking is breakaway guilt, because we usually do succeed in breaking these cycles. And what does it look like when we're the only one whose life has materially changed, not just materially as in money, which is a big one, but also materially changes in emotionally?
That's right.
What's it like when you're the one who's like healing and doing modalities and here on We All Grow, going to wellness days and just like really deep diving. And then you're watching these dynamics when you go back and these fights and the kind of, I don't know, you know,
the scarcity mentality, the, you know, so many other unhealed emotions. When you're the trailblazer, when you're leading the way, I think it's so incredibly, it can be so isolating, which is why I love your question of what were we born to break? Because there is so much intention. I think that you hit it straight. You hit the nail on the head when you say, you know, we can spend the rest of our lives trying to strive and break all of these traumas or heal. But in reality, some of them are not ours to heal. And we can only do so much with our energy.
And the second part, 100%. The second part of that too is, and the, it's a important part because it's the positive part of that question is, what were the cycles that we were born to create, right? And those are the ones that we have to have that balance in our lives, because we don't exist to just ward off negativity and ward off struggle. Like, we exist to create abundance and peace and rest, you know, something that's also a generational cycle that folks haven't been able to access. So it's not just about what you don't want, but it's about what you do want.
I love that. I love the intentionality around that question. So let's talk a little bit more. So early in the book, you write, to be a first and only in America is a delicate balance of surviving where you come from while acting like you belong where you're going. Success in the former does not make the latter any easier. In fact, the more effective you are at surviving, the larger the experience gap there is to bridge. So let's talk a little bit about the bridge concept, the trailblazer toll, and what many of us have to pay when we're the first and only.
Yeah, God, there's a lot there. And, you know, I talk about the bridge concept because a lot of times we feel that almost compulsion to have to bridge these two different things, two different cultures, social classes, communities, when the way I look at it more is we are the bridge, right? We exist as a bridge, a lot of times stretched in between these two things painstakingly, right? Mm-hmm. Some mothers that have been in the audience when I've talked before, they're like, yeah, we're the bridge and our kids walk over us, you know? But yeah, I mean, the bicultural balancing act piece of it, which is another one of these tolls, it's a very strong theme in the book, because especially in the high school to college years, that's when it feels like it hits you a lot of times for the first time. When I was in high school, you know, it was a school that was predominantly teenagers of color. You know, it was the 90s in LA, and my Latinidad was something I hung a lantern on. I wore on my pants, size 40 pants. but, you know, it was something that I didn't feel like I didn't have access to. It was just ingrained in the pride that I always had. But when I went to college, all of a sudden, that experience gap, that chasm, just, it almost like opened up to swallow me up. I went to USC, and, you know, if anyone wonders what USC was like in the early 2000s, they shot Legally Blonde while I was there on campus. So it was definitely a fish out of water experience. And so much so that I had a panic attack and passed out. I tell the story in the book, like fainting in the middle of campus, and my mom rushing me to the health center and them handing me a bottle of Xanax at 17 years old and being like, yeah, take this every 4 to 6 hours. And that was my first real experience with that experience gap, right? that 2 month summer, that blurry summer between losing my high school love and getting to USC and being in a completely different thing. I say in the book, the soundtrack to my life went from Dr. Dre to Dave Matthews Band. Like, that's
how, overnight.
And so all of that to say is that it just continued to build that chasm between these experiences, and my responsibility continued to build to feel that I had to be the perfect balance of all of it. You go too much this way, you're a sellout. Go too much that way, you're an outsider. And I know I don't have to explain this to anyone here. You know, we all know what this feels like. And that in and of itself is a moment to pause and to think about, as that mental health component of what that exhaustion of balancing does to us, you know, how that continues to move through these spaces we move into. You know, the idea of assimilation is interesting because I actually don't really ascribe to it for first gen individuals, because the idea of assimilation is like we get to this one place that we need to assimilate to. Maybe that's more our parents' generation, I don't know. But to me, it feels like this moving goalpost that just kind of keeps moving and moving. And we get to a summit and then we look up and we're like, oh, there's like 10 more summits on top of that. And they all look completely different than the other ones. And guess what? We barely figured out how to like keep my best friend from home while I'm in college. And now I have to go to grad school and move across the country. And now she won't talk to me. You know, there's, it builds on itself. It isn't like we have this one thing that if we can just do it right, we become like the perfect first gen person. There's no such thing.
No such thing. And at every point, we're faced with new challenges. And we're also often alone once we get to the next level. So you write about the need to recalibrate and to survive in every new space, and how in every time you reached a different marker of success, you were oftentimes greeted with misunderstanding and rejection by your old or your former environments and your former gente. Can you tell us a little bit more? And you alluded to it a little bit. You talked about it a little bit in the last couple of minutes about, you know, your high school friends and how basically when you went to grad school, it was a whole different ballgame. Can you tell us a little bit more about those experiences, but also about your time in DC and the dual rejection you experienced early in the White House?
I was going to say that actually the high school friend, the childhood friend earlier than high school, we were like 12 when we became friends. That very much goes to the DC part. So it's actually one and the same. You know, I write in the book about how I had just, when I went to grad school, it started, you know, I invited this best friend of mine to come visit, and I had been feeling some kind of distance between us, but finally she kind of blurts, I don't want to see your snobby friends. I don't want to meet your snobby friends. And I understand, you know, now how she was feeling, and I understand how I was feeling, because I was just confused. And I just started holding back this whole part of my life, thinking that that would make things the same between us. So I wouldn't talk about college or grad school. I wouldn't talk about my new friends. But we know when you're holding a part of yourself back from anyone, whether it's a friend or a romantic relationship or a family member, it's almost like the pea under the mattress in that old fable. Like you can feel that something's kind of off and wrong. Yeah. And so it just caused more and more estrangement between us. And when I made it to DC and I started at the White House, I send out this mass email where I say, you know, everyone, you know, this is where I'm at now. And I just got this job. And I had just gone through this really terrible experience in the media, which I'll talk about in a second. And I got a one word response from her to this email, and it was in all caps. And it said, unsubscribe.
Oh, that was so heartbreaking.
That's how I felt for real. It was like stabbed in the heart. And, you know, our friendship, we've seen each other maybe once or twice since then. And it's sad. It's sad to me to this day. And I understand that it wasn't anything personal. You know, I think sometimes we do lose things along the way. We gain so many things in the first gen experience. And that's a part of the point of this book. We lose a lot. And sometimes it's friendship. Sometimes it's estrangement from family. Sometimes it's, you know, our loves, you know, and sometimes it's even like a lot of stability and a sense of belonging that you kind of have to calibrate, that you kind of don't belong where you are or where you're going. So my friend, she probably thought that I thought I was too good. In reality, I was going through one of the darkest periods of feeling like I didn't belong and imposter syndrome ever, which was, you know, I had just gotten to the White House. They had posted or published this whole like takedown article on me showing old modeling pictures from when I had just gotten out of college and used it to question whether or not my intelligence, my right to be there, all of these just horrible things that frankly, I don't think now they could get away with having written things like that. I feel like we're in a different time, but it was just the most sexist takedown ever. And if you can imagine when you read the book, you've walked with me through the whole thing. And then you finally get to this summit where you're like, okay, I can take a deep breath. Like I'm here. I did it. This is now like this. This is the time I've been waiting for my whole life. And then they're like, boom, you're trash. You know, you're like, oh my God, it was horrible. All that to say is that had just happened when I sent that email. And I don't know what she thought I was feeling, but I certainly felt like I didn't belong where I was. I thought I was going to get fired. I thought that I definitely knew I was going to be a pariah. And again, I take you through all of it with me, but it was a dark time. It was a super dark time. Probably the darkest of my, well, one of the darkest of my life to date.
I mean, it, as a reader, I can only imagine how difficult that period of your life was. I felt so drawn to, like, I just wanted to hug you. I wanted to hug that Alejandra because I felt like she'd been so wronged. And can we just veer off for a second and talk about, you know, the reason why this takedown happened, in fact, was because you, without a financial safety network, like so many of us, you were just trying to make ends meet. So you had a modeling career and you were told, hey, this is a great opportunity. So you walked into an experience thinking, okay, I'm going to make some money. I'm going to, you know, this is going to help me. And years later, it comes back to haunt you. And how many of us, you know, if you could tell us a little bit more about that experience, because I feel like so many of us that are first gen make decisions because we have to, porque tenemos que comer.
Well, that's what I was going to tell you. You know, it's funny because a lot of times, and it doesn't have to be modeling, you know, like it was kind of like, I didn't just model. I waited tables. I like picked up glass in the, like, as a hostess stand on Sunset Boulevard, random bars. You know, there were so, the point is there was just a number of, I'm going to do whatever I need to do to make money. And a lot of us go through that, right? But to broaden that, it's also the idea that the things that we've done, the things that we've gone through, the choices we thought were available to us, how many times they can be weaponized against us when we get to that place that we've been trying to get to. And that looks different for everyone. We all have different versions of that. But there's certainly things in all of our past that can be used to shame us that at the time, we were, again, making the best decisions in real time that we knew how to make. And that's another part that is like kind of the tough pill to swallow for those of us that are first gen, because we don't have parents who can pay our bills while we do that internship or pay our rent or homes that we could live at while we kind of get on our feet. Because for many of us, living at home creates more chaos. You know, living at home can mean that we have folks in our ear saying, well, why are you doing that? That's dumb. Go get a desk job. Stay with that job. Don't take that risk. Don't start that company. Why would you take on those student loans and then go take a job where you make so little money? And the idea of these professional boundaries a lot of times means that we have to create physical, geographical boundaries in order to kind of preserve our mental health. So you're like in a rock or a hard place because you're kind of on this hustle. I call it the lonely hustle. You're on this lonely hustle. You don't have a lot of support. Folks are sometimes dissuading you from doing the things that you feel you need to do You're watching your peers get celebrated by their families for doing the things that you're getting questioned on. It's like, oh, you're applying to grad school. Let's throw you a party and give you a care package. For me, it was like, why are you leaving your job waiting tables at in Gladstone's here in LA? Like, why are you leaving your job? That's a steady paycheck. You make a lot of tips. You're going to go take a GMAT class and volunteer at a nonprofit. That doesn't make any sense. But that was the building blocks for me to apply to graduate school. So all of those dynamics going on at the same time. So you do what you feel you need to do, whatever that version is. And then God help us if 10, 15, add however many years later, they go, well, you don't belong here. Look what you did. God, how circular that is, right?
So circular. It's so wrong on so, so many levels. But to be completely honest, I am not sure that I had thought about that, thought about not only how cruel it is to weaponize someone's past, but I really hadn't thought about it within the context of our first gen experience until I read it in your book. And then it really started to make a lot more sense for me. It sort of some of my life experiences and some of my friends' life's experiences, really, I started to connect the dots in a way that I hadn't before. So I wanted to thank you for being so honest about your experience and being able to, you know, really, really put words to some of your own experiences, because I think that there's so much reflection that has to happen for a writer to be able to put it within the larger context, put one's experience within the larger context. And while we're talking about what happened in DC, let's talk a little bit about belonging, because belonging is such a important thread that you weave through this entire book, but really, I think it takes shape very beautifully when you're in DC. So you write, when you're first and only, you're set up to advance alone. You often don't belong by definition. I didn't have a network of individuals who could understand both where I came from and where I'd arrived, or help me make sense of why every time I leveled up after an achievement, meaning I reached a new threshold in my social or economic mobility, there also seemed to be a related emotional cost. So when I read this, I felt so seen. I almost cried because I was like, oh my gosh, it's not just me. It's not just me. Can you share with us a little bit about how you started to process and understand your desire to belong?
It's such a central theme. And it's been unpacking that is even recent in the last few years. You know, how much of my journey was driven by the fact that I didn't always feel like I belonged in my own family. You know, it starts all the way back.
Yeah.
You want different things. If you dream of different things, that feeling that you're kind of the weird one or the outsider, or even if you know that those are positive things, you're still not completely one of the group, right? And how that continued to follow me through school. You know, you're with me in high school when I kept trying to hang out with these girls that just bullied me and would just vote me off of the schoolyard. And I just kept trying to be there, you know, and then how it translates into being in adult professional spaces. And I say social mobility demands lots of costume changes in a lot of ways, you know, the ways of trying to find that belonging, what that physically looked like. And, you know, it took me a long time to finally let go of that kind of yearning for belonging with a capital B. And it's funny because the parts that we hide of ourselves because we want to belong, how those parts and actually being vulnerable about them are the connective tissue that actually leads to the belonging. it was a journey for that to sink in for me. But that was actually something I learned really young. And if we have time, I know I'm a talker, so I know we're probably very not into our questions that we were supposed to get, but I was going to tell a story from the
Please
story.
Tell us.
Okay.
Please tell us. Tú cuéntanos.
Okay, because I was like, I'm probably like ran through five of your questions at this point. The belonging part and the connective part really, really kind of sunk in, even though I couldn't articulate it then, when I was about 12. I tell this story in the book, but my mom had just been in a very chaotic, emotionally starting to tip towards physically abusive relationship, not to my father. And we had lived in this powder keg of a house. And one night, I won't give everything away, but there was this really explosive fight, kind of known as the rib scene. And it was why we actually left. And we moved into this affordable housing unit. And my mom fell into this postpartum depression. I was kind of on my own. So she went and she put me in this nonprofit, which maybe some of you guys have been a part of, because, a lot of us are Pell Grant kids, pipeline program kids. And it was a nonprofit for at-risk youth. They had it at a local park. I thought that they were teaching us like writing or acting, but they were actually trying to help us develop confidence and keep us just occupied. And one day they came and they put a pen in our hands and they said, okay, you guys are going to write a play. We're all like, write a play. Like teachers ever wanted to hear from us were regurgitating book reports, right? And they're like, no, write about what you know. And so we all started writing these plays that frankly were kind of dark, because we were all writing about kind of heavy things, not realizing it. Like the main character in my play was nothingness, like the personification of like depression, which was a 12-year-old play. It was kind of a little dark, but they take us to UCLA and they put us on the stage so we can sit and we can watch the audience while they perform. So I had an actress who, unbeknownst to me, had just come off of doing What's Love Got to Do With It with Angela Bassett. So afterwards, I'm walking through the audience, I'm a kid, and she had invited Angela Bassett there. I didn't know. So I feel a tap on my shoulder. I turn around and it's Angela Bassett. And I mean, just radiant, right? And she says, I just wanted you to know that I really personally identified with what you wrote. And I was like, first of all, like, what? It's like superstar, obviously different cultural experiences and backgrounds and ages and everything. But it really, really struck me in a way that that vulnerability, that sharing had somehow made her feel seen, me feel seen, both of us feel less alone. And it cracked something open in me that continued to kind of echo through my life, to your point. And, I think that kind of that vulnerability being okay, and if anything, being the way to find belonging, the way to understand that all of us belong to this beautiful community of just cycle breakers and trailblazers, and just to quote a very smart man, audacious, the audacity, right? Audacious people that believe without a doubt, that is the circle of belonging that we're sitting in now, and that ultimately just felt like an embrace.
Mm-hmm. I love that. And I love how this example that you share in the book really shows us that our story, our vulnerability, is really sometimes what saves us. It's what connects us. It's mm-hmm. what brings people closer to us. So mm-hmm. amigas, if you're out there and you're thinking, what do I have to say? What's the story that I have to tell? Think about it, because your story is ultimately what we all need. It's what we all want to hear. Mm-hmm. Alejandra, we're almost running out of time. I want to make sure that we have enough time for amiga questions. Let's wrap up this question with this last question. So you write, no one had validated to me how extraordinarily important it is for someone who is first gen to hone and follow their intuition. That inner knowing can, in fact, be wise. Can you tell us a little bit more about this realization around taking risks, and listening to your intuition.
Well, that's probably the longest chapter in the book, which is dealing with this. I called it blindfolded cliff jumping, you know, and the kind of almost existential level risk that as first and onlys we often face, because it's not only existential for us, but it feels like, wow, my family's depending on me for establishing some degree of financial security for them. For some folks, it's even to retire their parents, right? And so what are you exactly risking? And for me, I would often get dissuaded, like I said earlier, in taking risks in those really important moments when I felt like it took everything that I had to stay on course. And I started learning to listen and cultivate that intuition. You know, we have really strong intuition and inner voice as first and onlys. I really do believe that it's a part of that soul's journey, this knowingness, right? About the cycles we were born to break, about our paths, but cultivating it and learning to listen to it is a whole nother thing.
It's work.
It is. And a lot of times I would think, okay, this is how I first started accessing it. I would ask myself, what is it that I feel like I'm going to regret more if I go this way or if I go that way? Because for me, regret has always been worse than failure. So that's how I would make a lot of decisions initially. You know, it's just easy to calibrate it that way. And this is a true story, if I stay in business school and you know, see that through, am I going to regret not leaving, dropping out and joining the Obama campaign? Or will I regret more staying on, going to the Obama campaign and maybe I don't get a job? Am I going to regret not having gone to business school? And when I looked at it that way, I knew that I would always wonder, what if I had stayed or gone back to the Obama campaign? So I dropped out of business school 2 weeks in and, you know, went and took that unpaid job, not knowing what would happen. And again, this is one of those choices that I tell you that could have gone horribly. I had no money, no apartment, no car, no health insurance, no job. I mean, this was already graduating from business or from graduate school. So I could have easily fallen on my face. It was a total intuitive choice. And that chapter, the longest chapter in the book, is all intuitive choices. But that was really important to cultivate, because that was big crossroads in my life. And I know that even if I had fallen flat on my face, I wouldn't have regretted it, because I was honoring my own intuition, my own inner voice. And to betray that, to self-abandon myself, which is another huge theme in the book, that self-abandonment would have ultimately been worse. Because I could find my way back to a job. I could find my way back to a cubicle. But how do you find your way back to yourself when you've lost it?
Oh, such a good question. I want to keep asking you. I'm like, I have at least 5 other questions that I have lined up. And so I think this is such a wonderful way to sort of pause our conversation and dive into the amiga questions. And if we have a little bit of time, we can always go back to how do we find ourselves. But I think that ending here with learning to really listen to our intuition and really learning to honor who we are and what that vision is such a beautiful message to take a pause on, Alejandra. Thank you for including that. Oh my goodness, Alejandra, this has been so incredible. Your words are so powerful. Okay, so amigas, if you have a question, if you could just drop it in the chat. I know there is already one queued up for us. So I am going to ask Veronica.
I want to read all these, but I feel like they're going to disappear once we end.
Yeah, so Gabby's helping us. Yay, Gabby. Yay, team, we all grow. Gabby is helping us and she's putting them in queue for us. So here, Veronica, if you are still with us, if you'd like to unmute yourself and ask Alejandra your question. Veronica Serrano.
Veronica. Are you there, Veronica?
Okay, how about I read it for time's sake? So question for Alejandra. Throughout the book, you speak about of course, all the first gen guilts we feel to do for others. This is not a turn on and off mechanism. So you still find yourself doing these things and going through the first gen feels that don't ever end. And do you and your mom now reflect on the things and decisions she made back then? Does she understand all of your accomplishments, or does the struggle continue?
Great question. So I'll take them in order. Do you still find yourself going through these things? Absolutely. And I do not, I make a point also in the book to say that I am not all figured out here. I'm not somehow on the other side of it and all of this is gone. You know, this is something where I have to make intentional choices every day. And I had to make pretty big intentional choices during the writing of this book that challenged if I really believed and stood behind the things I was saying in the book. And also the idea of making ourselves into healing perfectionists. Like, that's very important for me after having been, you know, like very much in this perfectionist kind of coping mechanism to trauma, to not feel like now I have to be perfect in my healing. Otherwise, we're not worthy in that sense. So that's also a way we don't want to transfer one kind of working nonstop at one thing for another, right? So I just want to center that. And then I want to go to the next question. And I don't think it's not like, oh, it'll never end. Like, it never gets better. It does get better. But I think that's part of our life's journey. You know, like the things that made us who we were don't ever fade completely. And I don't think we want them to. Do you or your mother now reflect on the things and decisions she made back then? Yes and no. You know, my mom and I have a complicated relationship, as you'll know if you read the book, and I love her dearly. And, you know, we're very intertwined. It's almost like she was almost my big sister. My abuelita was my mom. And when I was writing this, that scene that I referred to, the rib scene, I wanted to read it to her before I printed it in the book, because I didn't want to re-traumatize her. And I wanted her to know and not be surprised by what was in. And I watched her get activated as I was reading it. And I felt activated too. And we were both just almost like back in that moment. But a really interesting thing happened recently. First of all, she didn't tell me to leave anything out, which I respected a lot. But recently I was at the LA Public Library and I was talking, and it was the first talk and only talk that she's been to. And she was there with a friend, and she seemed kind of, I know my mom so well, my hypervigilance kicked in. I could see her kind of uncomfortably sitting in her chair, and someone in front of her started crying when they asked her question. And someone behind her started crying when they asked her question. And I watched her kind of watching them, and she called me the next morning and she said, I get it now. Like, I get that this is bigger than my story and your story. I get what you're doing. I get why you wrote all of these things about our family, because, you know, we can feel like we're betraying our families by telling the truth, which it's not a betrayal, to be clear. And it can still feel that way when these are hard truths. And she said that for that reason, it would be healing for her too. And that meant a lot. So yes, my mom and I will never be perfect, just like none of this ever is perfect. And we can learn to meet each other where we are and to, again, embrace the nuance and complexity of these hard things and how they can also be transformed as we kind of move through our experience of them. And does she now understand all your accomplishments, or is that a continuous struggle? Yes and no. And I'm glad you asked that, because this is also a part of the first and only experience I talk about in the book, which is a lot of times we don't really get a lot of that kudos and applause from our family, which contributes to that isolating feeling. I would come home in the holidays when I was working at the White House, and no one would ask me about the White House. And they'd ask my cousin about his job at Trader Joe's, but no one would ask me about my job. And I understand that my family loves me, and they probably didn't know what to say or what to ask, or maybe there was some discomfort. And I don't, that's what I believe about my family. And that didn't make it any more disappointing. And keeping it real, because that's what I promised. Those are the first words of my book. I'm gonna keep it real with you. Keeping it real now, for sure half my family won't read my book. for sure. Not because they're upset at me or upset that I wrote it, but because they're not interested. Right. And am I going to say that that doesn't hurt a little bit? No, it hurts. It still hurts. I'm human. And I understand that getting the validation from people outside of us, including the people we love, our loved ones, our family, that's unnecessary. You know, we can validate ourselves, even validating what we experienced. I had an aunt tell me before she read the book, or I don't know if she's read the book, but before the book came out, she said, yeah, I said, you know, you may be upset about some of the things I write about Abuelito, your father. You know, I talk about his alcoholism. I just want you to know. And I adored my grandfather. I was his consentida. Like, no one loved him like me. And I was honest about the reality in my home. And she said, well, you know, I understand that's how you might have experienced it as a child. You know, so it doesn't, looking for reactions to our accomplishments, to our realizations, to our healing, you know, looking for these validations outside of ourselves, especially as first and always, but really for anyone, it just doesn't serve us. And I've made peace with not needing that anymore. And I'm telling you, last week when my cousin showed up at one of my book events, totally unexpected. She just like, I looked up from signing a book and she was standing there. I'm like, you came. She's like my only cousin who came. And I'm like, you came? She lives in LA. And she's like, yeah. And tears running down her face. And she said, thank you for writing this about our family.
Oh, I love that. Ugh.
All that to say is that, you know, we don't wait for it and we don't look for it and we don't need it, but it's still beautiful when it comes. And sometimes it'll come in the moments when we least expect it. So keep our hearts open for when those moments come.
So beautiful, Alejandra. So you're getting heart. I don't know if you can see this, but you're getting hearts and all kinds of love in the chat and the videos. We're at time, Alejandra. I want to be super respectful of your energy and your time. I know that you have been everywhere since this book was released. So I'm going to say thank you. We have a couple of questions left.
I know. It feels so bad. I want to answer all the questions.
I know. Let's
do one more.
Okay, let's do one more.
If you guys are okay with it. I don't want to, if we all grow, folks need to go, then we can go. But
no, I think we can do one more. Yeah. Let's do it. Okay. Priscilla, are you still here? Do you want to unmute and ask your question? Priscilla? No? Okay, I'll ask it for you. Alejandra, in finding acceptance.
Oh,
I'm here.
Oh, there she is.
Okay,
great. Hi.
Alejandra, un placer. Nice to meet you. But I feel like you kind of answered my question already. Basically, just trying to see, because I have had like my parents, I've shared stuff with them, and then I'm always grasping for that affirmation and basically trying to see whether or not, you know, how do you handle your own. It kind of is because you just said it, like, you know, you don't have to find affirmation from anybody else, but always like from your family, you want that direct, like, I'm proud of you, mija. So how do you deal with, you know, like that disappointment of not getting that affirmation while still like, you know, making sure that, you know, what I'm doing is the right path. Everything that I'm doing is right. But just like managing those expectations and unfortunately disappointments.
Yeah, I mean, to your point, I think I kind of went into that a bit, and it's kind of not needing it anymore, you know, and being open-hearted when it comes. But, you know, sometimes I will call my mom and I'll say, guess what, this happened. And it'll be kind of disappointing to not get the like, yippee kind of experience or response that you would want, you know, and sometimes I've made choices to not call certain people in my family when I know that I'm going to want some kind of response. Like I know what I want to hear and it's not going to come. And so I'll purposefully not call that person. because it'll be kind of more disappointing to not get that response. And maybe I'll call one of my friends, because one of my friends, one of our community here, and you know, like other first gen young people, our best friends, a lot of times they'll be the ones that shout from the rooftop and go, let's go have dinner, let's go have drinks and celebrate. So, and it's sad, you know, because maybe you want to call your mom, or you want to call your sister, or you want whoever that person is that is supposed to react a certain way. But that's the boundaries that I've created for myself. I'll still call those people and tell them, but I know that the first reaction that I want, you know, is going to be one that's just like celebrating with me in a certain way. And I'll seek out that person. So I hope that's helpful. But that's kind of how I manage it. And to end on like a positive note, I saw Sandra's question. Do you mind if we end on that one?
No, please, let's do it.
Okay, so I see Sandra Herrera. She said, do you finally feel like you have found a place in this country as a Mexican American that you can still be authentic to your culture, but continue to advance as your own innovative person? And by the way, thank you for your question, Priscilla. I appreciate it. To Sandra, I would say, you know, it was honestly about finding a place in myself more than anything, because now in my closet, like 5 feet that way, there's Nike Cortez next to high heels, next to boat shoes, next to tanny shoes, you know, like it's all kind of lives together in a way that I don't feel like I have to explain anymore. I don't feel like I have to bridge anymore, or I have to morph anymore. You know, the fact that we are all these things, all we have to do is exist and be unapologetic in the existing. So there isn't a place that we'll ultimately move to or live in or be in or attain that encompasses all these different parts of us, because it's kind of not possible. We're so multidimensional as firsts and onlys. That's part of the beauty of the identity. And just because people kind of have created these boxes for us doesn't mean we have to exist in them. So it may be confusing to some people. Some people may find us contradictory or you know, complicated, or not be able to figure out, you know, are you this or are you that? Or do you feel comfortable here? Do you feel comfortable there? But that's not our responsibility to make other people feel comfortable with who we are. So the place I finally found, again, I'm not trying to sound Pollyanna about it, but the place was right here. You know, that's where I found I could be comfortable as a Mexican American. And, you know, that journey looks different for all of us. But, you know, like I said, it's not the external anymore. You know, it's the internal, which in a lot of ways is the returning back to where we started. You know, the first gen experience feels like we have to become this, we have to become that, when it's really the return to who we were originally is that journey. So I hope that for those who haven't read the book, I hope you'll pick it up, and I hope that you'll share with me. You know, I'm super DMable and super LinkedInable. If you guys want to send me a message or tag me, if you read it and let me know what resonates with you, I love hearing that. But I thank you guys for being in this conversation with me. And thank you to Norma, who honestly, like, can we just talk for 10 hours? Because you hold the most beautiful space, and your questions, like, virtual applause, because you're such an incredible advocate for learning and reading and just healing in general.
Oh, Alejandra, thank you for your words. And really, amigas, if you haven't already, please, please pick it up. Give it to a friend. Alejandra told me, Alejandra and I saw each other in August, and she said to me, well, if you get another one, just just give that one, do me a favor, give that one to another first gen person. And I was like, done, mujer, done. So even if you've already picked one up, consider picking one up for your friend. The holidays are around the corner. This was so beautiful. And I just want to really go back for 1 second, Alejandra, to your statement of unapologetic living. Let's take up space. Let's embrace that which makes us special. Our first gen trailblazing, you know, spark, and let's all support this amazing author, this amazing book. Alejandra, thank you for being here. Thank you for going over.
Somebody just asked, can we take a Zoom picture, all of us, which I would love.
Oh, okay.
Can we switch to, I don't know how we switch to a view where we can see everyone.
Gabby, do you think you could help us?
Oh, there we go.
Okay.
You guys should get on camera if you're not on camera so we could take a picture. Hi, guys. Oh, I didn't see any of your faces before. Oh, my God. Look, you guys have the book. Hi. Okay.
Okay.
I don't know how to take a Zoom picture, so I'm just going to sit here and wait.
Okay, wait. Okay, are we done?
Take one.
Okay. Okay, let's do that. All right. So, amigas, if you haven't picked up the book, please support Alejandra, support this experience. When we buy books, we tell the publishing industry, we want more books like this. When we support our authors and our stories, it's really our opportunity to create equity in the publishing industry. If you haven't picked it up already, please do so. Alejandra, thank you again for being here. Amigas, thank you for holding space. If you would like to go into an in-depth conversation, I will be holding space at the end of the month to talk more about first gen and everything that Alejandra shares with us. Alejandra, one more time, thank you so much for all your time, for all your love. It's just magical.
Thank you. Love you and love you guys. Good luck on your journeys.
Thank you. Thank you for being here. Thank you, amigas.
Thank you.